I mean, I find it very ironic that today we are connected as never before, you know, through our cell phones, through satellite phones, through the internet, through Facebook, through any number of social media. I mean, we can talk to one another as we've never been able to do, and yet we feel more divided than ever. And why is that? Part of it is our failure as journalists, not to be able to explain, to bring about and say, you know, instead of focusing on why we're so different, why can we not start to talk about how we're very much alike? That we have similar basic beliefs, that we have similar desires. We want to raise our kids. We want to have a job. You know, we'd like to put a little money away, like to have a house or something. It's amazing how many people actually want that in the world. So regardless of the faith you have, regardless of where you were born, or regardless of the country in which you live, those are commonalities. And anybody who travels realizes that. The first thing they'll come back and say is, you know what? They weren't so different after all. We aren't so different after all. And I think if internationally we would start to see the world instead of always wanting to lead the world, if we realize we're going to share this planet, we have to do more listening, and we need to be more telling as far as journalists about what other people in the world want. We need to share, and we need to start conversing. And the problem is we don't spend a lot of time listening. We love to talk. And I'm talking about journalists, and I'm talking about, you know, talking heads on television. I'm talking about just as a nation. We love to talk. We could stand to listen a little more. I was born in Canada. Raised for a time in Canada. So, you know, I came with a view of other nations besides the United States. I am an American citizen, and I love being an American citizen. I'll say that first and foremost. I'm not, you know, one of those who says, oh, I'm a citizen of the world. No, I'm very proud to be an American. But I did come from a background that exposed me to other countries, to other cultures. So I think that was helpful. I traveled a lot when I was young, so that opened my eyes, and that made me realize that there is a whole big world out there. So that was a big help. And I think anybody who travels, and when you travel and then start to watch or read newspapers or see any of the media out there, you quickly realize that most of the newscasts in other parts of the world have far more international news than we do. I mean, what do we have? You know, you usually get a story about how, you know, four more NATO members were killed in Afghanistan today, or the latest bombing, or the latest riot in Karachi, or something like that, which, it doesn't really benefit you and really probably frightens more than it really informs. So I realized with my travels, that which I was just discussing, that we have a lot in common. So it was hugely beneficial. I would encourage you, and if you can't travel, and because I don't mean you got to go travel the world, go to one country, but try to absorb the culture. Try to spend some time with regular folks. And then the beauty of the internet today is that you can watch all these different news organizations from around the world and see how they report. And sometimes a different perspective is really enlightening. You know, you want to see something interesting, look at how Syrian television covers the American presence and conflict in Iraq. They don't like it, and they have a very different take on it. And I'm not saying you have to agree with that or anything by any means. I think in many ways it can anger you. But it also makes you realize, wait a minute here. You know, this is the story they're getting. Well, no wonder they don't like us, you know. listen to this, the way they're telling it. So it's very informative to sometimes listen to the reports of our fellow journalists all around the world, because they don't necessarily see things the way we do. And that's an aha moment. That's like, wait a minute here. You know, you realize that different journalists have different takes because of where they were raised, the experiences they had growing up, their take on America. So sometimes look at someone else's version of the story. I hate human suffering. You know, I cannot stand to see anybody suffer. I can't isolate myself from my own emotions. It's not that I break down blubbering and sobbing or anything like that, no, but I am affected. I mean, I can be sitting there talking to people and tears will start running down my eyes, or, you know, you feel it inside yourself as the emotions really begin to take hold. You're a human being. I mean, there's nothing about the journalism degree that somehow deadens your senses or removes you as a person. And sometimes I think that journalists can come across as robotic or so stoic. And I'm not saying you have to suddenly, put your arm around the person and start singing Kumbaya. No. But you have to realize they are human beings, that everyone you're dealing with is a human being. The audience that's out there, the people you're talking to, and the stories you tell, they have an impact. They affect people, and they are people who have been affected. They're not just a commodity, and they're not just a script that's got to be banged out in 20 seconds, and they're not just a, some kind of minute 20 that has to be boiled down and where you look good doing it. Sometimes you're trying to put in the words an event that most of us can't even begin to imagine. The embed process, when you're embedded with the military, is a tremendous journalistic challenge, because there is no way, when you are, you're eating, living, surviving, you're often under fire, you're dealing with the emotions of tremendous fear. When you see people wounded or killed beside you or near you, people you were just speaking to moments before, have an impact. I mean, this is where you are like, the soldier, only you don't have the gun. So I found that when you are embedded day after day and week after week, and sometimes for months at a time, there is a natural closeness that occurs. You can't help but feel a common bond. And yet, as the journalist, you're supposed to remain distant. It's as if I'm supposed to be hovering over all of this. I'm not really there. Of course, I am physically. But I'm supposed to be above it all and objectively taking this all in. That's impossible under those circumstances. Can't be done. And so that is the struggle I had. I realized I had lost my total objectivity. I felt a closeness. And the circumstances demand it, actually. I mean, if I'm supposed to say, well, I'll just dispassionately watch this ambush here. Well, I hope they all come out okay. Of course I do, because if they don't come out okay, guess who else doesn't come out okay in this thing? It's not like, whoo, that didn't go well. I'll just be going back to, No. So you're connected physically to the events that happened, but you're also connected emotionally. And that was the greatest challenge. And I will tell you, I didn't succeed then. As if my goal is to be totally objective and to be totally unbiased, and that is my role as a journalist, and that's what you strive for, I failed miserably as an embedded journalist. And there were days that I was like, I'm not doing the right thing here. But I also realized the deck was stacked against me. It was impossible to be an objective, totally objective journalist under those circumstances. So I guess I could hope that the trade-off was, all right, you're not getting from me. And I would tell CNN this. I would say, we better be getting other viewpoints. We better be getting other, views of the overall conflict here, because I'm not giving you the totally unvarnished, unbiased picture. I'm giving you the view through a straw, basically, of this war. And but I'm giving you an incredible insight to the front line, boots on the ground, what is it really like to be here experience. And that's the trade-off. Access versus total impartiality. It was a compromise. You have to, from a totally non-journalistic issue, you can't be a private person. Everything you do when you're in bed, including going to the bathroom, is going to be seen by everybody else. You can't have qualms with that. Even if it's men watching you, whatever. It's just, there are... privacy goes out the window. And I just want you to understand that. If you feel uncomfortable with it, embedding is not for you. You have to not mind roughing it. And I mean bugs crawling on you, as you're sleeping and getting bitten and scorpions, and all the kind of icky stuff. That's basic. You're going to be living in extremely harsh conditions, and no favoritism is going to be shown to you. Because of the profession. You're here, you will live as we live, and you have to follow their orders at times. Journalists don't necessarily like doing that, but the embed process is, as I just explained, a compromise here. You're getting opportunity versus probably having to make concessions that, as a journalist, you may not always be comfortable with. But those are the rules. You have to be knowledgeable. I would suggest maybe you try and learn a language. I mean, I've fumbled to get by with a few phrases here and there, but languages are good things. And now the ability to get language, especially over internets and other means, with low cost or no cost. Do that. Study up in the world. You know the history of many of these conflicts, know the geopolitical situations and why we're in these particular conflicts, if those are the areas you're going to cover. And you really have to want to do it. I mean, to the point that even when you get turned down, rejected, and passed on, that you're going to find other ways to gain the experience. I mean, the biggest problem you may find is people can say, well, you haven't got any experience doing this. I mean, what have you ever done? Maybe you have to sort of begin, and this is just totally making it up off the top of my head, but okay, say no network will hire you, or you haven't got that job yet where they were willing to send you overseas. You could perhaps, as a photojournalist, one-man band operation, lend your services out to some sort of NGO, you know, some sort of organization that's working in Afghanistan, that's, you know, trying to do good on a humanitarian level. And you could say, look, I'm willing to go and document this for you. This would probably be beneficial if you want to gain, you know, funding and all of that. You could show people back home what it is you're doing and how you're doing it. So that way, you gain experience. Dangerous? Absolute. Without a doubt, because there you're not working with troops. You know, we already know what have happened to people who work in Afghanistan, if that's the place, is a very dangerous place. And there are many others like it that get no attention whatsoever. I mean, you look at the number of journalists that are dying, more and more are dying than ever before. So, but if you really want to do it, please go do it. You know, it's needed. Really, really needed. I would have paid more attention in the classroom. You know, I think that's every regret eventually is as a student, you're sort of here to, you know, college is 4 years of let's get by, let's get through it, and let's get to work. And only later do you realize, boy, that was a pretty good opportunity to learn a lot of stuff. Stuff that actually I will use. I mean, college is actually stuff you will use. I mean, I'm not sure about some of the side courses you had to take, but the journalism and the RTV stuff is, yeah, you'll use this stuff. And I would encourage you, the more opportunity, and I said this yesterday, the more opportunity you have for hands-on experience to really go out and do stuff, to work at OUB, to work at On Air, or to work in what it is you specifically want to do. The more experience you can do that in the college, while at college, the better off you'll be in the long run. So just pay attention, show up at one more class, realize this is an opportunity here, and don't waste it.